Welcome to the 17th episode of the Film Illiterates podcast, your home for uninformed, unfiltered, ill-advised movie talk. Fun-filtered.
Honestly, it would have been great for the first, 5 seconds. We already dropped an F-bomb. We're already making progress there.
It's fun-filtered. It's wholesome family entertainment on this fucking podcast. I'm your host with the most terrible taste in movies, Joe Campbell, and joining me today is the man with a plan, or so I hope, because I sure as hell don't have a plan, Nathan Stone.
Hey, what's up, everybody?
And we're going to be talking about movies today.
Yes, because it's been, 3-4 months since we've done a last podcast or something like that, Joe?
It's been quite a while. We haven't had much on the YouTube channel at all, actually.
I know. I keep pinging you like, hey, when are we going to do this again?
Well, here we are.
We're living up to our word.
We're finally talking about all the things, you know, I'm getting up to people's cankles. Is that what you said? People get mad at us. Have you looked at the comments on some of our videos?
I have, yeah. People are such sticks in the mud. You know, they just don't know how to take a joke sometimes.
Well, I mean, to be fair, I'm not the most tactful person, but yeah, we get a lot of hate comments. I should do a comment comeback video. That might be fun.
Yeah, sometime. There you go. Give them a taste of their own money, you know?
Just or show off my ignorance. So, what do guys love more than Tarantino films? Tripped out cars, awesome explosions, and Dwayne's Johnson. Well, a lot of things, actually, but that's what we're talking about today. On this week's double feature episode, both Nathan and I caught the 9th film from Quentin Tarantino, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And we also watched the latest installment in the Fast and the Furious franchise, Hobbs and Shaw. Can we put aside our differences to find some common ground on these two summer flicks and keep our one-liner remarks to a minimum? Who the fuck cares? But that's what we're going to do, or not. Probably not, but we're going to try.
We're going to try. And no, we won't be talking about Dwayne's Johnson because we won't. So sorry.
I think you'll be surprised at how much we actually will be because I got some things to talk about in this movie.
Oh, yes. Same here. I will actually stoop a little bit lower just to talk about Hobbs and Shaw. Just for the record, I am not a huge Fast and Furious fan. I kind of did not really catch up with the franchise until recently. I mean, I kind of was watching them all the way up into the third one, and then I just stopped. And then everyone said, oh, they're really good. Watch them again. And so I gave it a shot.
But, have you watched all of them by now, though?
I don't think I've seen the last one that came out before Hobbs and Shaw. So I should probably check that one out.
Yeah, well, I'm all caught up, but it's been a while. Katie and I are actually working through the series right now. We're as of this moment, we're actually halfway through Fast and Furious, which is the 4th movie. Mm-hmm. So I'm just telling her, hang in there till Fast 5. It'll be worth it. Trust me.
It'll be worth it. Exactly.
But before we get into any of that, let's start by talking about what we've watched on our own recently. So, Nate, do you want to kick this off or do you want me to kick this off today?
I could probably kick it off.
Sorry, go ahead.
The films I've been watching haven't been too many. Mostly I've been busy with other stuff, but every so often I will try to get to the movie theater to catch what's new and great. And just recently I saw the latest Spider-Man movie, Far From Home. It was pretty good. One thing I will say about it is I think it's a huge upgrade from the first Spider-Man Homecoming as far as having a good villain and it actually being much more of a Peter Parker Spider-Man story. I think the first one with Homecoming, it was good, but we focused a lot more on just Michael Keaton's character, which was okay. It was great to kind of bring Tom Holland as, you know, this new Peter Parker into the Marvel franchise and make a movie, a standalone movie that worked with him. As far as all the other Spider-Man movies, it wasn't my favorite of them all. I mean, let's face it, Tom Holland's great as Peter Parker, and I think everyone just, that's a huge sell for the movie in general. But I think for me, I guess, Joe, with you and I, we'll always love the Sam Raimi one. It's a given, right?
Yeah, actually, coincidentally, last night, I actually rewatched Spider-Man 2, which is my favorite Spider-Man movie, the Sam Raimi Spider-Man 2.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I think for me, I just love how Sam Raimi directed them. He brought enough drama, he brought enough humor and campiness and just a lot of what Sam Raimi does well to make that, you know, property work. I think this one, especially with this new take on it, it works. And kind of sticking to Far From Home, I think what I liked about this is how they amped up the stakes for Peter Parker. Like, they really made this more about like him really trying to figure out his place in the Avengers team. And, you know, Tony Stark is gone. And if you haven't seen Endgame, that's a spoiler, but I don't care. But anyway, I liked it. I really liked Jake Gyllenhaal's character in this as Mysterio. I thought he had probably the most fun doing this, especially there's this point in the second act where this reveal is made. And you could totally tell, like, yeah, this is the reason why he signed on to do this. You can see him, like, bringing out his acting chops. But other than that, like, I thought it was good. The one thing that kind of bothers me, though, about the movie, and this is just a big one, and I think a lot of people share this as well, is the whole high school comic antics that happen. Like, you know, you have the substitute teachers who are so oblivious to what they're doing on this Europe trip. He has his best friend and him doing his thing and just all those little antics. And I think for some reason, I'm just tired of that. I got really tired of it after, like, half an hour into the movie. I'm like, okay, can we please move on, please?
Yeah, I actually really enjoyed Far From Home. I liked it more than Homecoming, even though Michael Keaton is one of my favorite villains in the MCU so far. But I don't know, something about Far From Home, I think the action was a little bit more interesting. I like Peter a little bit more in this one for some reason, and I can't quite pin my finger on it, and I'm not sure why, because Peter Parker in these movies, he is from a generation that I'm just totally disconnected with, and I grew up watching, you know, the Sam Raimi Spider-Man movies, which are so wonderfully intentionally campy, and I eat that stuff up. So this works fine, but for me, I'm always comparing it in the back of my head to, well, it's not the Sam Raimi Spider-Man movies, but it's still pretty darn good. And another thing that these movies, the Tom Holland ones, struggle with is the fact that he is kind of just shoved into a bigger world, and there's always that question of, oh, all this other stuff is going on around him. But I like it that they're kind of using him as a palate cleanser in that sense, that he is kind of smaller stakes. I love Jake Gyllenhaal in this one. He's a lot of fun, and what they ended up doing with him in the whole third act was great. It was a big spectacle set piece, and They got a lot more cerebral with some of their action set pieces, which I wasn't expecting, and I greatly enjoyed it. So some of the most interesting visuals since Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
So I quite enjoyed this movie.
Yeah, and I think what's really great about this is what made all that work, because, Joe, I think you're right. The action of this is actually very, very it's an upgrade from, like, what we got with the first Spider-Man Homecoming. And I think what just made this so enthralling to watch was, you know, this technology that what's being introduced. And that's one thing that's kind of cool about this, is that they're making Peter Parker's Spidey suit and what he's dealing with a lot more tech, you know, savvy, like a lot more tech centric, like the stakes he's dealing with, like the obstacles, the antagonists he's kind of going up against are dealing in a very high tech world, and he has to combat that. And a lot of just like what we see in the second act, as well as in the third act, is just a lot of fun in how he is trying to battle that. And I thought that was great. Oh, also, really great after credits.
I was about to say, my jaw hit the floor. I was not expecting that. I hadn't read anything about it ahead of time. No. And I was just floored.
Honestly, nobody in the theater was expecting that, but it was the biggest homage and the biggest hurrah and the biggest, like, oh my gosh, what the F moment that we've ever seen in a while for a lot of these.
I was so happy. I was just giddy during that whole thing.
It really now sets a new stage, because it's like, there's a lot of possibilities that they can now go with this for the next 10 years of Marvel. So we'll have to see what they have up their sleeve.
Yeah, but I want more of that.
All right. Well, I think I've milked that movie enough. Let's see. The next movie I ended up seeing more recently was Ari Aster's latest or second horror genre film, Midsommar. That was such a trippy movie. Joe, I don't know if you've seen this movie yet. Have you?
I haven't. In fact, I haven't even seen Hereditary yet. I am behind when it comes to my modern horror.
Okay, I have a couple of comments to say about this guy, and I'll keep him very to a minimum because there's a lot I could say about this guy. I like what he's doing with the horror genre because he's really, you can tell this guy knows his horror movies. Like, he's delving into like the 70s and 60s, like cult following movies, and there's a lot of just of the occult that he brings to a lot of the story in this. And I think there's that, it gives us such a creepy element to this, is the fact, like, you know, oh, someone could be, you know, a worshiper of this kind of a cult, and you could be totally brainwashed and sucked into this. And that was just something that freaked me the most out about this movie, is there's not a whole lot of like scare tactics or a lot of like jump scares that happen, but it's just how it ropes you in to like this community and what they believe in, and just how manipulative it can be, and just how these kids, not knowing what's going on, or think they know what's going on, or being reassured of what's going on, are so easily becoming victims as they go. It was such an experience, but towards the very end, kind of like with Hereditary, it goes to this other place and you were not expecting, and you can understand why a lot of people who are probably reviewing this movie are saying, we were not expecting that. And it sticks with you in a bad way, in a very bad way. I think a lot of movies that when I was watching this, I kept comparing it to is like The Wicker Man, even just a lot of like Ingmar Bergman films as far as the style goes and really capturing the Swedish landscape. And stylistically, I love this movie. I love the way it was shot, how they handled light, how they handled the set. I mean, it's all just done in this one community. And probably one of the most lucid and most accurate acid trip depictions I've ever seen, in just how they shot this. A lot of like towards the very end, like they just like shoot the atmosphere in a way that if someone was tripping balls, yeah, this is exactly what they would see. So I would say this movie I'd recommend for anyone who can tolerate it. If you have a very low tolerance for just like horrific gore and even just explicit sex scenes, I would highly not recommend this.
Yeah, Ari Aster is a blind spot for me right now. I've heard interesting things about Hereditary and that the ending is very polarizing, and that makes me more interested to see it. Midsommar, from what little I've heard, there's not as much buzz around it now that it has come out. Mm-hmm. The few things that I have heard is basically, yeah, it's really good, but it's exactly what the trailers kind of sell you on as, you know, creepy cult movie. Yep. More or less, which I'm down for. I actually watched The Wicker Man for the first time in preparation to see this, and I just didn't get around to seeing Midsommar.
Are you talking about the Nicolas Cage Wicker Man, or are you talking about the original 1970s Wicker Man?
The Christopher Lee one, the original one.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Yeah.
I will say this about something about Ari Aster, and this is one thing I like about his films so far, is how he always has this element of a family tragedy tied with how it progresses this plot line. It's kind of something similar that happened in Hereditary, and it happens again in here. And I think there's something I like that he's hinting on, and how the victims just open themselves up to these, or because they go through this experience, they're much more vulnerable or just become easier targets for just the horrific disasters that are about to happen. And I don't know, there's something about that I kind of like, that he brings that to his style. Other than that, his movies go into really weird places. And I don't know, Joe, maybe you should watch Hereditary first before preparation of this, just kind of know that. Last thing I watched was 2001 A Space Odyssey. So the Ken Cinema was having a midnight screening of this, and I made the mistake of having way too much beer and not enough coffee going in. And you know, it's 2001 A Space Odyssey being screened at midnight. You're going to doze off halfway through of it. But, you know, just watching it again on the big screen, Joe, this is one of your favorite movies of all time. It's just impressive to kind of think back then. they were doing all these practical effects from scratch. Even like the wormhole scene when they're going through space and time, just knowing that all of those lights and all those colors were kind of just made from hand. It's like, that's impressive.
Yeah. I actually thought that you were going in a different direction with that. Oh, I had too much beer and I went to go see the movie. I thought you weren't going to say that you fell asleep, but that the final sequence, into the infinite sequence, was just going to blow your mind completely.
I mean, I will say, like, when you're listening to it with a, you know, surround sound, it's a huge difference. But yeah, no, I mean, it was just great seeing that again on the big screen. And I had watched this documentary on Stanley Kubrick and how he made 2001: A Space Odyssey just before going into this. And you kind of like just take that in and see what's being projected on screen. And it's the reason why it's a masterpiece.
Yeah, that movie was the first movie that I can remember that I really dug into, you know, what does a movie mean? What is going on here? I read up everything that Stanley Kubrick had written on it. You know, I read the original book. I really delved into what is actually going on here on a narrative level, but also on a thematic level. And it's a fascinating movie. And it just, it's, even though it's long and boring, long and boring to a lot of people, it never gets old for me. And I love it.
Yeah.
Every minute of it.
Exactly. Yeah. So getting to see that again at the kin was good. Other than awesome. That's all that I've watched.
Alrighty. Well, a couple of things that I watched recently. I watched Juno for the first time this past week, actually.
Oh, interesting. You haven't seen that movie before.
I had never seen it before. Juno is a 2007 movie directed by Jason Reitman, starring Ellen Page and Michael Cera. It says, faced with an unplanned pregnancy, an offbeat young woman makes an unusual decision regarding her unborn child. And I was looking forward to this one because kind of everyone I talked to has had nothing but good things to say about this movie. And I just, for some reason, I hadn't gotten around to it. I think it's kind of in a genre, kind of the mumblecore indie comedy, which I've never really gotten into. But I'm glad I did. I think the movie is very honest in its depiction of how teenagers think and feel, at least, you know, back in 2007, to my knowledge. Diablo Cody's dialogue is a little ditzy, but it seems to fit the tone of the movie, so I was fine with it.
I think, if anything, I remember seeing that movie when I first entered into college back in 2007. And I just remember the dialogue is something I think just made it stand out from everything else. I kind of feel like if that dialogue wasn't as quirky, wasn't as off the wall in its own beat, I don't think the movie would have worked.
Well, yeah, it's part of his whole identity, you know, all the that's one doodle can't be undid, home skillet, all that kind of stuff, which I know drives some people crazy, which I would understand if the movie wasn't good, but the movie's pretty darn good. It's one of the few movies where I desperately didn't want there to be drama watching it. Maybe part of that's because I'm a father, and you know, I've gone through the whole we're having a kid and going up to helping my wife out through pregnancy and the childbirth and everything.
So Joe has experienced some PTSD while watching this movie.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm watching this. I'm just like, and like you know Juno decides she's going to put the baby up for adoption, and she goes to meet the parents, and everything seems to be going well. And I'm just thinking like, please don't let there be any drama. This is just a nice little movie to watch right now.
Here's one thing I kind of liked about the movie as well is there's a lot of moments when you think you could be really on the nose with what they're feeling or experiencing, but they use subtext very well in this movie. There's that one part where she's discerning, okay, should I go to the abortion clinic and get this done? And it's just because this one person said it has fingernails. She's like, dang it, why did you have to say it has fingernails now? Darn it. And that's kind of what changed her mind, even though that's probably not what it was the big reason.
Yeah, there's a lot of nice little touches throughout this movie. Of course, when the drama does hit, that's kind of where the movie lost me, because they bring in a whole kind of an extra problem with Jason Bateman's character. And it feels like it's kind of coming out of another movie. And I wasn't sure how it was fitting into this one. And I was kind of like, I don't know about this. This is kind of an out of left field sort of thing. But the way that everything resolved, I don't feel like I was quite satisfied with, because I get that. Yes, life is messy. And I think that was kind of the point of the movie, that we had to make the best with the situations we're given. But me watching this movie, I'm just kind of thinking like, I don't know if this is the best thing for all concerned. And I feel like everyone is just kind of making the best of a bad situation, but it didn't leave me feeling like, I almost want to follow up with them, you know, a year or two down the road and see how everyone's decisions in this movie, how it's affected them and whether they wish they could go back and do things differently or how are they going to move forward now. And so this is a movie that I would have loved to have seen a sequel come out like 2 years later, but it's a little bit, you know, late for that.
Yeah, I'm kind of wondering what a sequel to Juno would be about. Maybe when she's like, what, like maybe 10 years older and the kid wants to track her down and actually, wait, oh, there is a movie that's like that. It's called The Kids Are All Right. Never mind.
Anyway, mild recommendation for Juno. It gets a lot right. It rubs me a little bit the wrong way, but for the most part, it's a pretty good movie. Mm-hmm. My daughter turned 4 this year. I took her to her first movie, which was in theaters, which was Toy Story 4. But then recently I took her to another movie. We went to go see Kiki's Delivery Service came to our local theater.
That's right. Because I think, during the summer they show a lot of, Miyazaki films in the theater.
That's right.
So I guess, yeah, they're doing that marathon going on. So how did she like Kiki's Delivery Service?
Well, she'd actually seen it before, on video at home, so she was really excited to see it in the on the big screen, you know, having gone to a movie theater once before, and she enjoyed it. It's just a happy little movie, you know. This might be the sort of thing that I was kind of hoping Juno would be, which is, oh, no real big drama, but little things here and there, little hiccups along the way. You know, according to the synopsis, a young witch on her mandatory year of independent life finds fitting into a new community difficult while she supports herself by running an air courier service. So, yeah, it's just this 13-year-old girl who's a witch in training, flying around on her broomstick, trying to deliver packages to people. And everybody likes her, and she's got a few little social drama. You know, there's this snotty girl who's kind of mean to her, and there's this little boy who likes her, but she's not into him. And it just... nice little movie. It's such a happy little movie. And I think we need stuff like this every once in a while. It was perfect for my daughter.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's great when you can actually have a story where there is stakes, you know, there is a chance of losing something. But, you know, most of the time, you know, you don't have to make it dark or dramatic like that. Like, you're right, Kiki, a lot of Miyazaki's films, if you think about it, are not very drama-based. I mean, there's some. But a lot of them are just really to try and capture an experience or even just a childhood memory. I mean, that's the one thing I remember always just liking about Miyazaki films like Kiki's Delivery Service, My Neighbor Totoro, is a lot of it is just us dwelling in that atmosphere, the forest, even in just in the setting. And sometimes kids need that. They need to learn patience and they need to learn to appreciate what's around them.
And I think in some ways it's easier for us to really engage with smaller stakes than it is mm-hmm. with bigger ones, because very few of us will know what it's like to have the weight of the entire world on our shoulders. But everyone can relate with, oh no, they need to get from point A to point B. We don't have a car and it's pouring down rain and this thing I'm carrying is going to get wet. You know, it's a little relatable stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's much more fitting for, you know, kids at that age, because it's like, you know, that's really all you do need to care about is not getting wet when you're going to school. You don't need to worry about a witch that wants to, you know, take over half the town and you have the key. It's like, yeah, they can't handle that.
Anyway, that's a high recommendation for Kiki's Delivery Service. And finally, I watched both versions of Little Shop of Horrors recently, the 1960 Roger Corman version and the 1986 Frank Oz.
I keep forgetting that. Yeah, there was a 1960s version of Little Shop of Horrors.
Yeah, so I'd seen the 1986 version before, fairly recently, and it's become one of my favorite movies. It's every time I watch it, I've seen it 3 times now, and every time I watch it, it just inches a little bit higher up on my best films of all time list. And when I say the 1986 version, I mean the 1986 director's cut version with the original ending, mm-hmm. which the original ending takes the movie from being great to masterpiece.
I know it's so sad when the studio system has to like chop up something that great, because it's like, you know, all for the sake of like, oh, we want to keep audiences in the theater, we want this to sell tickets. But it's like, yeah, just give it the ending that the director intended it, because that's why they're timeless.
Well, that the whole thing behind that ending is kind of fascinating, because Frank Oz wasn't really pressured to. In fact, during the making of the movie, he was planning on doing the original ending, which is the same as the play, which is basically just a very, very dark ending, but a kind of whimsically dark ending because it's a musical. And he was going to use that ending, and his, I think it was one of his writing partners or producers or someone helping him with the movie kept on telling him, this isn't going to go over very well with audiences. And he said, nah, it'll be fine. It's the same as the play. And they showed it to a test audience and they hated it. It was, and for this is Frank Oz talking, saying about how much people just were just quiet. And they walked out very down about the whole thing. So he agreed to change the ending to a much lighter, happier ending. He was disappointed about it because there's, oh my gosh, so much effects work in that whole finale. I mean, just tons of practical effects that were lost for years. Mm-hmm. And he was bummed about that. And the people who worked on the movie were bummed about it. But he knew at the time that's what he needed to do to make a commercially successful movie.
Yep.
So I'm glad that we have it now restored. I think for today's audience, they're a little bit more open to something more kind of nihilistically, bitingly, hilariously dark. But it's also fitting to the what happens in the story and with the characters. And it's all part of the tone.
It's all part of the tone. Yep.
So Little Shop of Horrors was based on a Roger Corman movie that was shot in like a week. And Jack Nicholson comes in. He plays the masochist in the dentist office. Dick Miller is in it as a guy who likes to eat flowers. And it's a comedy. It's not very good, honestly. For a Roger Corman movie, it's okay. It's just kind of boring and cringingly not funny with little bits of hilarity here and there. I was more interested in it just kind of historically. I'm currently reading the biopic of Dick Miller, mm-hmm. who's one of my favorite, most beloved actors. And it talked about his role in that movie, specifically in the making of that movie. So I was interested to watch it finally.
Nice.
Anyway, let's move on to our main topic, which is Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and then we'll talk about Hobbs and Shaw.
To my right is Bounty Law series lead and Jake Cahill himself, Rick Dalton. And to my left is Rick Stutt Double Cliff Booth. So, Rick, explain to the audience exactly what it is a stunt double does.
Actors are required to do a lot of dangerous stuff. Cliff here is meant to help carry the load.
Is that how you describe your job, Cliff?
What, carrying his load? Yeah, it's about right.
So before we get into this, I just want to give a disclaimer. We will be talking spoilers for both Once Upon a Time in Hollywood and Hobbs and Shaw. So I don't know when we'll jump into spoilers, but just from the get-go, it's going to be a spoiler-filled discussion. So you had your warning.
And probably at that point, we lost half of our viewers or listeners.
Anybody who's going to watch this podcast has seen the movies by now.
They probably have.
Or one of them. So Nate, what did you think about Once Upon a Time in Hollywood?
Oh gosh. Okay. So, I don't know how to say this properly, but I think this movie might be one of Tarantino's finest movies, but it's the least of his movies. And I'll explain. I think what Tarantino is doing here is not necessarily making a Tarantino film. Even though you can definitely watch it and you can see those trademarks everywhere. Like he has the drawn out scenes, he has the build up tension, he has the ultra violent explosion that happens at the end that just goes crazy. But honestly, if you really look at this, he is not trying to make you laugh. He is not trying to, you know, give you a memorable, cool action scene, even though there are some peppered throughout it. But what I like about it is that he is really just trying to give you a look at a time period. He is really trying to give you a look in an era that was dying and being replaced. So the story in a nutshell, Leo DiCaprio plays Rick Dalton, who is in kind of like an aging action actor, and his stunt double, who's played by Brad Pitt, are trying to still find work in the industry when they know they're kind of has-beens, they're washed up, they're not getting the kind of recognition they are anymore. And they're just trying to find their way in this landscape that once was Hollywood, you know, as they come into the 70s. But there's this whole entire, you know, storyline that's around the actual Charles Manson murders of Shannon Tate. The ending is kind of something I think I'd like to try and get into if we have time, Joe, because I really like what Tarantino does in the end and what he's actually saying throughout the movie. But in looking at it and thinking about it, he breaks away so much from his original style. And I think a lot of that is in the editing. And I think a lot of it is that he wasn't really focused on giving us like memorable lines or memorable scenes with these actors. He's just trying to give them kind of like a look of what this was like. I mean, there's a scene where basically Brad Pitt drives home from, you know, dropping off Rick Dalton at his place in the hills. And he just goes to his trailer where you see, you know, his weights are outside. He has his bulldog that, you know, he's about to, you know, feed. And you spend 10 minutes of him just opening up these cans of dog food and him making mac and cheese. And all of it is really just to capture an atmosphere. But you hear in the background, the TV is playing and all the ads that it's playing on in between like the shows and the serials. And it's just something that Tarantino, I think this was really what he wanted to show, was he wanted to capture that again in a film. And somehow I liked that. That's the stuff I liked about it. There's a lot of scenes of just filler. I call these filler scenes, but it's really just like scenes where Brad Pitt or Shannon Tate or any of the other actors are just driving around town. Literally, all it is just them driving around town, going from one place to the next. And there's nothing exciting happening in the background. It's just you're listening to the radio, hearing the music that's going on, seeing the landscape. And I think that's really what Tarantino was just trying to show, was this was a time period when you had that and it was kind of being faded away as it's being replaced by another era.
Well, that's because I think it feels like that because the movie is primarily a hangout movie, much like it has more in common with American Graffiti than a lot of Tarantino's previous movies.
Exactly.
Where you are just following people driving around doing their thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's an argument to be made that Reservoir Dogs is a hangout movie with just robbers with a heist that goes wrong. Mm-hmm. But it is a heist movie. I mean, it's people in a scenario under tension, or Pulp Fiction, which you could argue just, oh, it's a hangout movie with a couple of hitmen for part of the movie. But again, there is sort of a driving mm-hmm. narrative of, you feel like we're getting somewhere as the movie progresses and there is a ratcheting tension. Mm-hmm. Now, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, the Manson family subplot, but it's kind of just hanging around and it's not the main focus until, you know, the third act. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the movie is really just watching Rick Dalton and Cliff live their lives and you get to know more about them. Mm-hmm. So a lot of it is based on revelation of these characters in flashbacks, which, by the way, did you find the flashbacks in this movie confusing? Because there were a couple times when I didn't know that a flashback was starting. And I thought it was just next part of the movie. And then all of a sudden I realized, oh, wait, this actually was a flashback.
Yeah, and that was actually something I mentioned about the editing of this. This is a reason why I feel like this is the least of Tarantino's films, because there are scenes where I could have seen him keeping together as just one scene. A good example is the Shannon Tate scene. You know, when she's basically, she goes into Hollywood, goes to this little movie theater, watches herself on screen and hearing people react. And that scene is chopped up. It's intercutted with a lot of stuff that's going on with Rick Dalton and Cliff as they go about their day. But I thought to myself, you know, if Tarantino was going to make a Tarantino film, he would have kept that whole Shannon Tate scene as one scene from beginning to end. And that was one thing I was noticing. Yeah, even the flashbacks, they kind of just happened and there was no clear segue. And it's something that's not very Tarantino in style, but it's kind of like, yeah, when they happened and you didn't really see it coming or see how it fits in it, but it somehow it kind of fits.
Yeah, well, I kind of tying back to my thoughts on Kiki's Delivery Service, I think all the Sharon Tate scenes in the theater were some of my favorite parts of the movie. Just because it's watching a woman enjoy her career and enjoy the joy that it brings, her career brings to other people, and just getting giddy at the sight of herself on the screen.
Oh yeah.
And it's, I get that since we're dealing with the Manson family murders and we have to get there eventually, I feel like those scenes are kind of for the audience who knows what's coming. They're thinking, oh no, I don't want to see what Tarantino's going to do with that scene, because we know that he has to go there eventually. Mm-hmm. And because you're just enjoying being with Sharon Tate here in the movie theater, enjoying seeing people laugh at her antics on screen, mm-hmm. you know?
And actually, that was one thing I wanted to actually comment on. I think you noticed this, Joe, but the way they treat Shannon Tate in this movie is very interesting, because we have Margot Robbie who's playing her, and you think they would basically rotoscope and even just CGI her head into the scenes with Shannon Tate. But no, they actually just keep Shannon Tate in those actual movie clips from the Dean Martin movie that, you know, she saw herself in. And I found that fascinating because Rick Dalton, you know, they replace his face in all these, you know, scenes. And there's a scene where he's like, oh, yeah, I could have gotten this part in The Great Escape. And they put his face in the place where Steve McQueen was. And you get in. It's kind of done well. But no, with Shannon Tate, they treated her in an immortalizing way.
Yeah, it's respectful.
Very respectful. And that's actually now something I want to talk about is the ending of this film. Because I think, in my opinion, that ending is literally what this whole movie was, is just a build up to, you know, it's going to be the Shannon Tate murders. You know, this is Charles Manson's family who are going to go and kill her. You're just building up to it. In fact, in the last act, Tarantino in his writing actually specifically makes time codes of like, at this time at night, they're here. At this time at night, then this happens, and it's building it up. And I think the big punchline at the very end is they don't end up killing her. They decided to bust into Rick Dalton's house and Brad Pitt and his dog tear them to shreds.
Now, here's the thing. Did that ending surprise you?
No, actually, I kind of saw that was coming.
Yeah, I was in the same boat, especially I think if I hadn't seen Inglourious Basterds, I wouldn't have thought that they'd be going there. But like, even since they announced this movie, my first thought was, oh, they're going to Inglourious Basterds. They're going to massacre the Manson family.
Yeah, but that's another trademark of Tarantino's, is he does a lot of revenge wish fulfillment endings where it's like he creates this fantasy of like, well, what if we took out Hitler and all the Nazis? Well, what if we took out this awful plantation owner? And he kind of rewrites history in that kind of a sense. And I knew he was going to do that. I was just kind of curious on how he was going to do it, because, you know, with something like Shannon Tate's death and how it was done with the Charles Manson family, it's a very delicate kind of a situation, which if you do it wrong, it could be very offensive. But I don't know. I thought this was treated very well, only because it does give off this illusion of, yes, this is a fantasy. But even at the very end, where you have like this part where after they kind of kill the Manson family and the day is saved, there's this scene where Shannon Tate is talking to Rick through the intercom. And I don't know, there's something just very immortalizing and very kind of respectful I kind of saw in that. Like, you know, I don't know if it was Tarantino just trying to say like, you know, I did Shannon Tate justice with this kind of an ending. I gave her the you know, life that she can still have in this movie, and we can have that. But I don't know, I found that tasteful. I found that very tasteful.
Here I am, flat on my ass. Who I got living next door to me?
I'm Sharon Tate. I'm in the movie.
You're in this?
That's me. I play Miss Carlson, the Klutz.
Oh. Charlie's gonna dig you. And that gospel
group. So I quite enjoyed this movie quite a bit for the most part. I think I might have a couple of issues with it, though. And I'm not entirely sure. This is a thing. I mean, on the scale of Tarantino movies, I'm not the biggest Tarantino fan. I've greatly enjoyed more or less all of his movies to some degree, some than others. I enjoy them, but I'm not like a Tarantino fanboy, or he's not like on my list of favorite directors or anything.
Right.
So a couple of things rubbed me the wrong way. One was the ending is a lot of fun and very cathartic and over the top and violent. But there's a little thing with Cliff, who is Brad Pitt's character, that I'm not quite sure what Tarantino was driving at here, and I'm not sure how I feel about it, in that there's a running subplot that Cliff may or may not have murdered his wife.
Yes.
And it's very plausible that he might have. The movie never tells you, but to us, the audience, who's on his side, we think, oh, there's a chance this guy might have actually done this, but we don't know. It might have been an accident. Maybe he didn't. Maybe he did. But having that question in your head there kind of makes the ending a little less fun, because then I feel like we're watching a maybe wife murder just bashing more people's faces
in. Yeah, I was kind of getting a feeling from that when he's basically taken out two of the Manson girls in the way he did. I'm like, oh, this is kind of unpleasant to watch.
Yeah, and if it was just something like, you know, bashing up Nazis, like good guys bashing up Nazis, then that's one thing and it's kind of fun. This, though, I mean, like, yes, the Manson family are murderous monsters, but this guy is kind of giving into a darker side that he may have, and I don't know how I feel about that either.
Yeah, it's almost like, is Tarantino trying to justify this kind of character, this kind of person's behavior, and giving it this kind of reward, which, and to some degree, he doesn't. I mean, he kind of does get stabbed and he does get taken out. But
he's a hero. Everyone idolizes him.
Yeah. And it's kind of like, is Tarantino trying to get on the stands of glorifying, you know, a character like this, even though it's the Manson family, because you kind of put him against the Manson family. It's like, well, yeah, any, you know, wife killer is going to be better than the Manson family. But it's like, yeah, you're right. Is he trying to justify this, or is he trying to vindicate, you know,
I'm just wondering why he brought up the whole wife murdering subplot to begin with, because it's very intentional and he very intentionally doesn't tell you what happens. So I would love to hear Tarantino talk about this and how it relates to the end of the movie and why he put all that in there. Cause I'd be curious to hear what his justification is for it, because just me not knowing,
yeah,
it kind of feels a little nasty.
Honestly, and that's another thing I also had an issue with this movie is the writing. As I mentioned, it's the one film I like from Tarantino, but it's the least of his films because, yes, his writing is not the strongest in this. In fact, there's a part in here where they're trying to show a passage of time of 6 months, and he does the laziest thing, which is he gives exposition of what happens to Rick Dalton and Cliff Booth when they go to Italy to film all these spaghetti westerns. And I kind of feel like, oh, Tarantino, you could have done something better than that. But I feel like, I don't know. I don't know if that was just him being lazy on his part or if there's a reason behind it. I'd feel like I'd have to go back and watch it again. But there's moments like that where you're right. He sets up this backstory with Cliff Booth, and you don't know if he's trying to, you know, validate that kind of behavior or if there is truth behind it. But you're right, there's some parts where that falls flat. I think another thing people might have an issue with is when Cliff Booth goes to the Manson family ranch.
And I love that scene. That's actually my favorite scene in the movie.
Actually, I love that scene too, but a lot of people have been complaining about, well, there's this buildup of him going to the house and you want to know what's going to happen. And then it's like, oh, that's the reveal. Okay.
That's why it's so great. It's the tensest scene in the movie, all this buildup. You don't know what's going to happen. And imagine how deflating it would have been if exactly what we're expecting is going to happen happens.
I think that's another thing that I kind of like about this movie is that Tarantino is actually, you know, building up our expectations of what we are expecting in his films and giving you something completely different. And I think that's one thing that I liked about this film is that he's breaking away so much from his style. He's able to create some very interesting scenes, but it's not going to be memorable in the same way that, you know, Inglourious Basterds or Django Unchained are, where it's like, there's just such quotable lines. I mean, I'm trying to remember like if there's a quotable line in this or something that people would want to just like hang around and talk about, like, you know, everyone does with Pulp Fiction. There isn't a whole lot of that in this.
There's my favorite joke in the movie is the it's called manslaughter. And kill anybody. It's called manslaughter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Bruce Lee scene. I love that. Yeah.
Yeah. So I love the scene at the ranch. I love Bruce Dern and his rolling over in bed scene there. I always love Bruce Dern. He's one of those actors that just brings a smile to my face whenever he pops up on screen.
And honestly, that was very appropriate as well, just having Bruce Dern. I mean, obviously, you kind of knew he was going to show up because it's a Tarantino film. But I loved how he was placed in that scene and what that scene was all about.
Well, that role was originally supposed to be Burt Reynolds. Yeah, he was cast in that role until he died and wasn't able to show up.
Wow, great way of bringing this down, Joe.
I don't know where I was going. I didn't structure that sentence properly.
That's something I want to talk about before we wrap up our conversation on here. Is there's something I like about this movie that Tarantino is driving at? Having guys like, you know, Leo DiCaprio and Brad Pitt, who, let's face it, they're movie stars, and they're bringing and they're leading this whole movie all the way through. And even like having actors like Bruce Dern, or even just revolving around this character like, you know, Shannon Tate, these are actors of the bygone days. And there's this whole melancholy of just, you know, these actors are kind of on their last few legs. They only have a few more roles or movies under the belt, and they don't know what to do after that. And it's kind of just capturing that all. And I don't know, that's one thing I kind of liked about that one scene with Bruce Dern and Brad Pitt coming to say hi to him, is it's a nice little reflection of that, of like, you know, old times. And even at this ranch that used to be where we shot movies, but these hippies have like taken it over and they're just squatting here. It's kind of just an interesting look at, this is what Hollywood used to be and this is what it's become now.
Yeah, I will say, I think in hindsight, I'm actually kind of happy that Burt Reynolds didn't end up playing that part, because I would have felt sad if the last time we ever saw Burt Reynolds on screen was as a washed up movie ranch guy who just being used by a cult would have been kind of sad.
Mm-hmm. And honestly, Bruce Dern, I think, fit that so much better, honestly.
Oh, he's fantastic in there. One last thing I want to touch on real quick is another minor problem I had with this movie, but it was kind of the first thing that jumped out to me as soon as I finished my screening, was when the Manson family subplot takes place when they come up to the house. That movie, up until that point, had been Rick Dalton's story just as much as it had been Cliff's story. And I feel like Leonardo DiCaprio's character, Rick Dalton, I feel like he's kind of sidelined at the end there. It's kind of like he spends the whole... All of a sudden, the movie isn't about him and Cliff. It's about these murderers and what are we going to do in this one scene. And he's just kind of sitting out in his pool. And then in the aftermath, he just kind of rushes in with his flamethrower and then says, "Oh, no, Cliff, are you OK? All righty. See ya. Bye." Mm-hmm. And so I feel like the movie's kind of taken away from him, especially considered how much investment had been put into his crisis and him acting with the little girl and wanting to be recognized and feeling like he's a washed up actor. And to be fair, maybe his arc concluded with going off to Rome and getting married. And you could see that as kind of the culmination of him coming to terms with where he is in his career and just enjoying it for that. But because the movie keeps going on, it feels kind of odd that his arc concludes, but there's still a whole bunch of movie and something completely separate from him, which only involves Cliff and this cult. Pops up for the end there, so that's a minor thing for me.
Yeah, it's a minor thing, and like I said, I think that might be just the hard balance that Tarantino is trying to show with this world, where he is really trying to show a world of actors that they are going through this, as well as just this dark undertone of, well, this is the new generation that Hollywood was kind of breeding at the time. This Manson family that felt we're going to stick to the man by invading these actors' homes and killing them. It's an interesting line to balance, but I think that also comes from how Tarantino was writing this and a lot of tropes that he is like cemented in his style that he breaks away from. I mean, I don't know if you noticed this, but there's no chapter dividers in this.
Oh, yeah.
Which is something like you kind of think on afterthoughts, like, oh yeah, there was no chapter markers, but I think it's not really kind of like the kind of story he's telling. He's not trying to show a chapter driven story. He is just giving us a look of a time that's come and gone and what was being replaced. So I don't know. You're right. I think there is that whole kind of like interesting focus change of, we don't really feel like that DiCaprio really completed an arc in the end, especially when he just comes in the end like that. But I think if anything, what I kind of just took away from it is this whole world of like actors thinking there are boundaries with what they can play and how they need to be accepted or just welcomed in. And I don't know, I think just at the very end, you're right. It would have been great if it ended on Cliff Booth, but the fact that we kind of linger a little bit more and we see Rick Dalton have this conversation with Jay and Shannon and being welcomed to their home and at 3 o'clock at night is, I don't know. I thought it was like a nice little ending. It really kind of showed like, you know, Rick kind of feels like he has more opportunities coming ahead of him. And maybe that's what Tarantino was trying to say at the very end with Rick's character, is the world's not going to end for him. This isn't his last horse he's going to ride. We don't know what will happen now that he's being welcomed to Shannon Tate's home. Maybe he might get a role with Polanski. Maybe he might be in Chinatown. Who knows? But I think it loves how it just ends on that note. So I would give
a recommendation to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
I will say though, for anyone who's going to go see it, make sure you eat something first and make sure you drink enough coffee before going in, because those 3 hours, you feel it. You do feel it.
Now let's move into a quick discussion of Fast and the Furious presents Hobbs and Shaw.
I think this is going to be more than just quick. We're going to crank this full throttled up, man.
Pick a door.
All right then.
No. That's my door. Pick another door.
What's wrong with you? You know what? You were right. This is your door.
What's the matter? You got a lot of bad guys behind that door?
Lawman, Luke Hobbs, and outcast Deckard Shaw form an unlikely alliance when a cybergenetically enhanced villain threatens the future of humanity. I had to to reread that. I almost want to say Cyber Lee genetically.
That is a tongue twister for sure.
The movie's directed by David Leitch of Deadpool fame, and it is stars Dwayne Johnson, Jason Statham, Idris Elba, and a bunch of cameos. Yeah,
Vanessa Kirby's in it as well, who is she was in Fallout, Mission Impossible. If anyone,
it also stars Ryan Reynolds and
Kevin Hart.
Oh, what's his? Kevin Hart. I was gonna say who stars with The Rock and everything.
That was actually when those two showed up in the movie. I got the biggest gut reaction of just laughs. I mean, just knowing them and just knowing what to expect from them, and just how Kevin Hart just came out of nowhere. He's like, "Hey, I'm Kevin Hart." I'm like, "Where?" And you know it would have happened, but it's like how they came in. It was just so perfectly timed.
So, all right. I've been looking forward to this movie since the trailers came out, because I love the trailers. And I like Hobbs and Shaw in the Fast and the Furious movies. They're a lot of fun. And I sat down for this movie. I was all hyped up for it. And I just kind of got this sinking feeling after the first 10 minutes. And it kept going down. And this was a late night showing. And by the time we get to that third act, action scene, I was nodding off in the theater.
Oh.
I was having trouble paying attention during the big action scene at the end. Here's the thing. This movie is just so... every time Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham are on screen, they're just shit-talking each other. That's all their dialogue is. The entire movie. And it's not even really clever shit-talking either.
Yeah, you're right. It's like, you know, stuff that 10-year-olds would basically be doing, you know, to themselves.
So many balls jokes.
It feels like this is like the missing dialogue from, was it Good Boys that's coming out, that the new Seth Rogen film? It's like, this is all the dialogue that didn't make that cut. They're like, oh yeah, we're going to give it to the Hobbs and Shaw movie instead.
Yeah, it's just, there's really nothing to their dynamic other than we're just, every line's going to be a dick measuring contest. It's just literally in many of these cases. Mm-hmm. And it got old. It was old as soon as it started. I think that the moment I realized I wasn't going to enjoy this movie, because I really didn't enjoy this movie very much.
You didn't enjoy this.
It's not terrible, but I was not happy a lot during this movie.
Oh man, I mean, it's at the very end with the helicopter and all the jeeps.
That's when I was falling asleep.
What kind of kept me going on when that happened. I'm like, yes, but this is Fast and Furious.
The moment that I realized I wasn't going to enjoy this movie was they do this thing in the beginning where it shows both Hobbs and Shaw's morning routines, and it juxtaposes them with a split screen, which is fine. It's a clever little gimmick, and it works. And you know, you see that Hobbs is, you know, he drinks eggs and does all this kind of gritty street level, cool, you know, weightlifting, all that kind of stuff. And Shaw is played by Jason Statham. He's doing all these kind of more elegant, gentlemanly things where he wears a suit and
he has avocado toast in the morning or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, all right, this gets the point across. And then they walk into the respective clubs where they're going to perform their hits, basically. And Jason Statham picks up a champagne bottle and Dwayne Johnson picks up a couple of shots. And you're like, all right, I get it. And then they do the stupid thing where Dwayne Johnson says, I'm an ice cold can of whoop ass. And Jason Statham says, I'm what you call a champagne problem. And I'm like, oh, we got that just from the visual joke like a second ago. But I guess you had to tell it to the dum-dums in the theater just because you want to be clever.
Joe, this is the Fast and Furious audience, okay? There are certain criteria.
Here's the thing. The Fast and the Furious movies, some of them have been really dumb, and they played to really dumb audiences. The first few, especially. But the later ones, especially, I would say probably 5 through 8, there's a difference between being silly and over the top and goofy and treating your audience like they're idiots. Mm. And this movie felt like it felt like they thought, oh, we know our audience are dum-dums, so we'll just target it for dum-dums and treat our audiences like they're stupid. Mm. Whereas the previous few movies have been like, all right, we're going to drive a car in between two buildings. That's fun. That's over the top. That's crazy. And there's some of that in there in this movie. But so much of it was just, it felt like jokes where I was like, oh man, I would hate to meet the person who's just sitting there, just being like, you made another balls joke. but the person sitting next to me was doing that the whole movie. So I guess. Okay.
So I don't think you can blame the movie for sucking out the fun. I think you got to blame this other person for sucking out the fun.
No. Well, here's the thing. And then Ryan Reynolds comes in and he's just doing his Deadpool shtick. And I was so happy because I like Deadpool and I like Deadpool's shtick.
Yeah.
And I realized that it was kind of lazy just to do that here, but I enjoyed that. And so I enjoyed every scene that Ryan Reynolds was in because I like that. But the rest of the movie, I'm just literally every line of dialogue between Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham is just comparing, like, oh, I'm better than you and I'm going to insult you. Let's think of how many insults. It's like bad comedies that where the actors improv and then the improv goes on for way too long. And you're like, oh, they should have cut out like half these jokes and just kept the best mm-hmm. one in.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I had lots of problems with this movie.
I mean, honestly, that was one complaint that several people had is that they felt this was pretty long compared to most of the Fast and Furious franchise movies. And maybe that could have, you know, helped it if they cut down some of those jokes. So while you didn't like this movie, I found this quite enjoyable. I was enjoying it. And maybe that's also just kind of portraying a little bit of my maturity level as well. But at the same time, here's the thing. I didn't like follow so religiously with the Fast and Furious movies when they came out. Because I know like the banter, the insults that they're passing back and forth. I know that this is also just a trademark of all the Fast and Furious movies. Like they dedicate a lot of time to that. Maybe in the past few movies with the Fast and Furious, from what I understand, Vin Diesel and how he has that with the rest of his crew has gotten better and a lot more refined because they realize, okay, our audience has grown up with these movies. We need to, you know, get to a better level of writing this. Whereas this movie, you're right, it might have just completely backtracked to just that, you know, square one of like, yeah, we're dealing with these kinds of dum-dums again and we're running right for that. But I don't know. I think it's just very self-aware of just how stupid it is. I think Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham realize, yeah, we're just two action-packed guys who are going to be like beating up bad guys and talking shit about each other. But that's what we're going to give and that's what the audience is going to love. And I love how committed they are to that. Despite how stupid it is, they stay very committed to that. And maybe that's what I like about it.
Well, I think part of it also might be what I like to call the Ian Malcolm effect, which is in that in Jurassic Park, Jeff Goldblum's character, Ian Malcolm, worked great for that movie as a side character. Then along comes The Lost World, Jurassic Park, the second movie. And I think that movie suffers quite a bit from promoting his character from a secondary character to the protagonist. And I think he can't carry that movie. And I think we're dealing with a similar situation here where Dwayne Johnson, Jason Statham, they're playing pretty much the same characters that they have been playing this whole series. But I think they work better as secondary characters in bits and pieces. So, for instance, in one of them, I forget if it's 6 or 7, Dwayne Johnson has this scene, I think, where he like doesn't he like rip like a Gatling gun off of a helicopter and walks around with it on top of a building shooting down buildings or something. I don't
pretty
remember.
Pretty much, yeah, that sounds accurate.
But that worked because I remember that scene because it was a highlight of that movie. And I was like, oh yeah, that was the fun scene where Dwayne Johnson goes crazy and picks up a giant gun. This movie is nothing but that. And when you have nothing but that for 2.5 hours, it just really wears down on you. And you're like, all right, where's the straight man? There is no straight man in this movie. Everyone's ratcheted up to 11.
I mean, I guess there is one straight man, but it's not a man. Vanessa Kirby, I think she plays the straight girl in this. And
sort of. I mean, she's toned back, but she's still all buddy-buddy chummy. I mean, what we need is a character who can be like, all right, we need to get down to business. This is what we're going to do. Stop goofing off. And then they're going to keep goofing off. She wasn't really that. She just kind of was along for the ride and just went along with their antics, even though she wasn't on the same level.
And
as
at
them.
The same time, like as I was watching it and I see what they're trying to do with her character, I'm like, you could have had this opportunity to make her that straight character to kind of like bring everyone back to ground base. Let's figure this out. I have this thing in me. We need to get this out. And constantly reminding them about that, which she tries, but you're right. She gets kind of brushed aside. And it's a shame because I think she does some good stuff with her character when she has the chance, but then she kind of just gets demoted to the damsel in distress scene. And it was a problem I had with her character.
She's,
for sure.
She is basically the MacGuffin of the
Pretty
movie.
Pretty much, yeah.
I love Idris Elba. Idris Elba was having a hell of a time.
Yes. You could tell he's, I love how he's like, I'm the Black Superman. And he's just like completely just owning that. Like he is on this motorcycle that's just like changing with him. And it's like, it's, his stuff is really fun to watch.
You see, I think when Idris Elba's on the screen, I get that he's having fun. He's just there to, all right, I'm going to play this over the top role, and I'm just going to roll with it, you know. And he does it with this kind of cool, you know, shrug that he has. But then we have Dwayne Johnson, Jason Statham. Again, I think their chemistry is one of the worst things of this movie, even though it kind of makes up the movie. But part of that also is because I felt like they were trying too hard. Dwayne Johnson is there just to say like, hey, I'm going to give you a one-liner here. I'm going to give this really fun line. This here comes the next one. And Jason Statham just sitting there like, I'm here to say something about God projectile vomiting in my eye.
Yeah, you're right. I guess when you think about it, it is kind of, it draws too much attention to itself on that kind of an end. And maybe that's something like, I guess, you know, it works with someone like Kevin Hart and Dwayne Johnson, because if it's a size thing, you know, you get the short guy and the big, you know, Samoa guy, and their antics together fit. You're right. With them, they're just too different and they're not polarizing in the good way. And this is kind of opposite to what a lot of people have been saying. Like they say they love this pair and they think, oh, we've been waiting for this for such a long time. And maybe they have, but maybe the writing could
be better. I love them in the other movies.
Oh yeah. But like you said, they're side characters and the focus is not about them. When they come on, they're there for comic relief. To dedicate a whole movie to that, you got to have something else there. And I know they did try that with bringing the whole family aspect again. You know, Vanessa Kirby is Jason Statham's sister, and they're trying to repatch these things in the midst of this crisis. You have Dwayne Johnson's character who has to go home and repatch things that he hasn't done with his family and bring them into the mix to help have them help them save the day at the very end. I thought I was going to like that scene a lot more with them all dressing up in like their Samoan tribe, you know, garbs and them like doing the haka chant just before they go out clubbing these bad guys to death. But it didn't have an effect on me. I think you're right. I think towards the end, I was kind of like losing it. I was like, it's losing steam at that point.
Yeah. And again, at that point, it was just kind of, it was late at night. I got everything that happened. I didn't actually like fall asleep, but I was starting to nod off. Cause I think at that point it's 2.5 hour long movie. And I just wasn't invested in any of these characters beyond this is a fun action scene, and here's another fun action scene. I did feel like it kind of felt like it went on for too long. I remember at one point, there was a big action scene, and I was thinking to myself, wait, we haven't even gotten to Hobbs's family yet. And I know that we're going to have a big action scene there, and I feel like we should be winding this movie up now, but we've got to have at least another half hour left, right?
Right, yeah.
Some of the action was fun, though.
No, that was actually one thing I loved. And kind of like, because they're trying to show the parallels with like, this is Hobbs and this is Shaw and this is how they do things. You know, there's scenes like, you know, the famous one that we've seen from the trailers is when they're in these corridors and they're taking out these henchmen. We have Dwayne Johnson who just is walking and dragging this big guy that he took out within like 5 seconds when he entered the room, whereas Jason Statham is like still battling like what, 10 different guys, and you just see Dwayne just like walking with this guy and he's like, dude, you gonna hurry up? So like there's fun stuff like that. And even like when there's a whole car chase scene in London that I think is just done brilliantly, and that comes to the credit I think of the director, David Leitch, just because he did do the John Wick movie, the first one, as well as Atomic Blonde, so he knows how to shoot action scenes and choreograph them very well. And I think these action scenes were just really fun to watch in general. But there's just
That is one complaint that I've heard a lot of people say, is that the action was too chaotic and shaky. I didn't have that problem with it. I thought it looked fine. Yeah,
at least like, you know, there's that one scene where Idris Elba crashes through a double-decked bus, and it's all kind of like gives the illusion it was just done in one take. I'm like, okay, that's impressive. That's the kind of stuff I like to see. But I think it's like towards the very end, I think the action kind of started losing me, because I don't know, it kind of pulls off a similar, Fast and Furious moment where it's like five cars get all hooked up together to bring this helicopter to the ground again. I'm like, yeah, we've seen that before.
We've seen that before, which is weird that we can say that in 2019. Yeah, we've seen 10 cars bring down a helicopter before. What else you got?
Yeah, but these are Samoas. It's like, but we've seen it before.
We are not easily impressed in this day and age.
We're not.
You know. Imagine back in the 80s, yo, dude, we hooked up 10 cars to a helicopter. Oh, man, that's going to look great. Nowadays, we're just like, yeah, what else you got?
What else you got?
I wish that, what's her name? Gonzalez from Baby Driver. Mm-hmm. I wish that she was in more of the movie. She was great.
That would be nice. Yeah, that would be nice.
I hope Ryan Reynolds comes back for future movies because I like his Deadpool shit. It's fun.
I think, you know, what's hilarious about that is... I think they literally just hired Ryan Reynolds. Like, hey, can you come in? We do not have lines for you, but can you just ad lib on the spot? And he's like, sure. Yeah. Just give me a camera.
Can you just play Deadpool?
That's what he's going to be for the rest of his life, is he's going to just Deadpool every single movie he's in. And
hey, it's better than being Green Lantern.
That is true. And he will continue to call out to that movie as well as Wolverine X-Men Origins. you got to appreciate also someone like Ryan Reynolds, who's gone this far in his career, but he is still willing to make fun of himself. And that's one thing I did like about this movie, is that I think Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham know their shtick. They know their shtick. And they're going to continue doing that just because they know that's what audiences pay their tickets for. And I think that's the one saving grace, at least in this movie, is like they give what the audience was hoping for, which is Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham calling each other dick names and kicking ass. That's basically what they brought. That's what they delivered. And I applaud them on that.
Yeah, they certainly delivered it. Not my thing, at least not for a full movie. Maybe if it was shorter, maybe I wouldn't have felt as strongly about it. And again, I didn't hate this movie.
No.
I mean, I think on Letterboxd, I gave it like a 2.5 out of 5 stars.
That's pretty low.
Well, I mean, it's not. I mean, 3 is technically positive, so 2.5 is like right there in the middle. So when I graded this movie, I just kind of thought, it had a lot of cool action scenes, and there are a few moments that made me laugh, but just overall, I did not. As someone who enjoys a lot of the Fast and Furious movies, this movie just did not do it for me. Yeah, I don't know why.
Maybe you just needed some of those Applewood cigarettes that DiCaprio was advertising at the end of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Which, by the way, let me just say, I actually love the fact that the movie Once Upon a Time in Hollywood ended on that note.
I am not a smoker, but that commercial made me wish I was.
You could look just like DiCaprio if you smoked this.
He made those cigarettes look damn appetizing. I gotta say.
Actually, you know what the actual commercial ad in there that got me the most was at the very, very end of the credits when they played the Adam West Batman
promotion. Yes.
That was fantastic. I was listening. I'm like, oh, thank you, Tarantino. That brings me back.
So, Nate, I presume you would recommend Hobbs and Shaw?
I think like if that's something that, okay, so like if you saw the trailer and you said, I want to see that movie, you're going to get that movie. Literally, it's in the trailer. It's going to deliver on that end. I don't think it's going to give you anything you weren't expecting. It's not going to give you something that, oh, that was a weird 180 that we were not expecting. No, it's going to deliver what you saw in the trailers. And I would say if that's what you want, yeah, go ahead and give it a shot. If you love Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham and that's everything that you wanted to see in this movie and nothing else, yeah, go ahead and give it a shot. But I think, you know, for me, I guess because I didn't really grow up with the Fast and Furious movies, a lot of the stuff, Joe, that you said, okay, this was done better in Fast and Furious 5 and 6 and 7. Yeah, maybe. But for me, I enjoyed this. And maybe it's also because originally a friend and I were going to go see Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. They are sold out. And so we were like, well, what's the next best thing? Oh, Hobbs and Shaw. Well, okay, we'll do that. And so maybe my expectations were lower for this movie, and maybe that's why I enjoyed it more.
Well, there you go. That always helps. I've found.
Too. Yeah, just realize it's going to be shit, and it'll be just good shit.
Anyway, that'll be it for our Once Upon a Hobbs and Shaw in Hollywood episode of the Film Illiterates podcast.
I really hope that's going to be the title of this episode, Joe. That would be
as of right now. Unless I can think of anything better, which I probably won't be able to because I'm a lazy bastard. That probably will be.
Honestly, I think that's perfect right there. Just keep that title as is, no edits.
Nate, where can people find you?
All right, well, you guys can follow me on Instagram at Nathan Stone Films. You can also find me here at Film Illiterates. I do these podcasts with Joe and Alex, who is not here with us tonight. We should mention that at the very beginning. I was actually really hoping he was going to be part of this talk because if there's anyone who's a huge Tarantino fan, it's him.
We'll have to bring him on when he catches it on Blu-ray, because I guarantee you he's not going to make it out to the theater.
Honestly, he is the one person who's always behind on the times. We actually need to give him a what was it? Like, he listens to a lot of music, so we got to give him a music podcast one day. You know,
give him music episode.
Yep, and we'll be the ones who like, oh yeah, we didn't listen to the album. Sorry.
I don't listen to anything newer than 1992, which is kind of true, actually.
Well, Joe, where can we find you then?
You can find me on Film Illiterates or at Film Illiterates on Twitter. I also run the Film Illiterates Facebook page, but I'm not as active on there. And you can find me on Letterboxd if you look up film_illiterate. You can follow up. I vlog everything I watch on there, so you can see my terrible taste of movies and everything. All my hot takes. So many hot takes.
Lots of hot takes. At least they're not like hot cakes, which is what Dwayne Johnson eats in this movie. A huge freaking stack of them.
Do we see him eat any of those, or do they just pile up like a 2-foot-tall pile of pancakes in front of him?
I think it's a given that everyone knows Dwayne Johnson eats that many pancakes in one sitting. He can.
You think those were real pancakes, or are they just like fabricated like plastic pancakes?
I guarantee you probably that was his meal for the day. So like, yeah, just give me a full stack. I'll just eat here on set. And it's like, okay.
Anyway, tune in youtube.com/filmilliterates to keep up on all our videos. Go through our backlog. We got a lot of great videos to make you very angry because we didn't like some classic movies that you may have liked.
What is one that people give you so much shit for, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, one of them is Repo Man. Because Alex and I just did not, we weren't on the same wavelength as that movie. And I enjoy Repo Man quite a bit, but I don't think it comes across as we liked it very much in the video.
I mean, I honestly, I give you guys a break for that because that's like one of your first ones as well. So you've grown better.
This was earlier there. Boys from Brazil, we get a lot of shit for too.
Really?
But that one just kind of like anybody looking for a Boys from Brazil review is going to love it. And I do like that movie. But again, that's one that I think we talk about the negatives more than the positives. And we come across as being down on it, even though I actually do really enjoy that movie.
Honestly, people need to get thicker skins, man. Thicker skins.
Yeah, we're having fun here. We all have fun.
Yeah.
Anyway, everybody keep watching movies and keep it easy.